Hola, mi nombre es Ana Pais y soy periodista de BBC Mundo. En el día de hoy voy a estar entrevistando al premio Nobel de Química Venki Ramakrishnan en el marco de la décima y última charla del ciclo virtual de entrevistas que estuvimos haciendo junto con el Hay Festival y BBC Mundo, llamado Imagina el Mundo. Así que, welcome, Venki.
Buenos días.
Buenos días para ti también. Bueno, I'll do a brief presentation of your life and work in Spanish, and then I'll switch back to English for the questions. So, Venki Ramakrishnan nació y se crió en India en una familia de científicos, y luego de algunos años estudiando física en Estados Unidos, cambió de área y se pasó a la biología, donde terminaría especializándose en biología molecular, y particularmente en estudios vinculados al ribosoma. Y fue justamente por estas investigaciones sobre la estructura y la función del ribosoma que en 2009 recibió el Premio Nobel de Química junto con otros dos científicos. Actualmente trabaja en el Laboratorio de Biología Molecular del Consejo de Investigación Médica Británico, que está ubicado en Cambridge, y es el presidente de la Royal Society de Londres, que es la Academia de Ciencias más antigua del mundo. Bueno, y como dije anteriormente, esta es la charla que cierra el ciclo Imagina el Mundo, donde 10 de las mentes más brillantes del mundo estuvieron hablando desde su perspectiva, de su respectiva área, sobre cómo será nuestra vida después de la pandemia de COVID-19. So, voy a volver al inglés. So part of the dynamic of these talks is that it won't be me, but our audience, who will be asking you the questions. And just to be clear, I will not always say who sent the question because sometimes the person wants to stay anonymous.
Yeah. Can I say a few words in Spanish?
Yes, please.
Yeah. Lo siento, pero aunque he estudiado español unos años, ahora he olvidado todo mi vocabulario. Así solamente hablo en inglés ahora.
That's cool. Well, but that was very good. A very good Spanish. Thanks for everybody who sent questions. And so here's the first one. Samantha Melchor asks if you, as a biologist, think that this pandemic could have been foreseen or even prevented.
I think prevention would have taken a lot of efforts on the part of governments all over the world. But it was predicted. It was predicted by many people. It was, Bill Gates had a TEDx talk on one of the most dangerous threats would be a pandemic. And it was also the number one risk on the UK's risk register. So anyone who was surprised by it simply was not well informed. It was always a threat. And there is, even after this pandemic, there will be future pandemics, which might be more dangerous, in the sense they could be more a more dangerous virus that spreads in this similar way. So, but prevention would mean prevention would be very hard, but dealing with the pandemic would require preparedness. And it would mean that countries would have to set aside some resources, some infrastructure, etc. And one analogy Bill Gates made is that even if we don't want to fight a war, we prepare by having militaries, even during peacetime. Okay, and we have a standing army, we have things like that. And you could regard that as a waste of money, but it's actually a kind of insurance policy. And so we may want to have preparedness, reserve capacity in hospitals, reserve staff, who are doing other jobs, but who are trained. So when a pandemic comes, they can be called on, etc.
Good. And there were lots of questions showing some skepticism, I must say, about our ability and will to stop polluting the world and destroying biodiversity, as well as coming out of the pandemic being less arrogant and suspicious. And these are all things that you mentioned in a talk that was published, yes, by by the Hay Festival on YouTube a couple of days ago. So first, let's talk about the environment and how can we start living harmoniously with nature, and why is it so important?
I think part of the problem is that in economic models, the environment and nature is not accounted for. So when a company manufactures something, the environmental costs of the manufacturer are not included in the costs. And one approach that we are studying in the UK is how to include the cost. You have to think of biodiversity as an asset, just like, you know, if you have oil wells, that's an asset, you know, or if you have natural resources of some other kind, it's an asset. So you can think of biodiversity as an asset. And if you're destroying biodiversity, you're destroying your assets. So you could include that in the economic cost of doing business and impose, you know, regulations, et cetera, which would take into account that cost. I think that would be a way to change practices because otherwise, you know, I think without regulation and without, you know, broad consent from governments throughout the world, you can't rely on individual companies and corporations, let alone individuals, you know, to change it, you know, so it would have to require a mass movement.
Good. The second thing is the arrogance of human beings, a concept that draw a lot of attention between our audience that you talk about in this video I was talking about. So what did you mean by that human arrogance, and why do we need to change it?
Well, we live in a very complex world, and what has happened in the last sort of 100 years or maybe even longer is that we have become technologically very advanced. You know, we can fly all over the world. We have, you know, satellites, internet. We discovered antibiotics. So for the last 60 years, if you have bacterial infection, you know, many of them can be treated by antibiotics and so on. And so this gave us a feeling that we're somehow masters of the universe. You know, everything is under our control. We are the boss and so on. And what this pandemic has shown is that, look, you know, here's this virus with 30,000 bases, you know, in its DNA, it's an RNA virus, but you know what I mean. 30,000 bits of information in its genome. We have 3 billion bits. And yet, you know, it has essentially brought the world economy, you know, to a huge, just almost to a halt. You know, all these countries went into lockdown. In many countries, the pandemic is still going on, especially in South America. And so it tells us that we are not actually in control of everything. And, you know, this is happening with climate change, with flooding, you know, with, you know, tornadoes, hurricanes, etc., as well as diseases and so on. So we must try to have some humility and realize that although we know a lot, there's much, much more we don't know. And we also don't know enough about how to optimize our place in the world, you know, where there are lots of other living things. So that's what I meant, I think, by humility, to understand the limits of our knowledge and to try and, you know, be a bit more humble in the face of nature.
Good. So you also talk about in this video, you also talk about inequality. And related to that topic, Jonathan Rabassa asks, if only the powerful and rich countries will survive after the economic recession we'll be experiencing at global scale, meaning inequality won't be solved, but will get worse. What do you think about that?
I think that unless we make a serious effort, your question, the person who asked the question is correct. That is, there is a serious risk that the pandemic will actually make inequalities worse. you can already see, you know, one of the things was that the pandemic is a great equalizer. After all, everybody can be affected by the virus. This is not true. You know, if you're wealthy, you can live in your villa and socially isolate yourself and have people bring you food and, you know, supplies and so on. You have access to the best medical care. Whereas if you're poor, you have to often go in crowded situations where you can get infected. If you get infected, you have no, you know, recourse. You might have loss of income, which is a problem which can be as big as the virus. You know, if you lose your job and you, you know, lose your house and can't eat. I mean, those are serious problems. So I think that we have to think about what I meant in the video is it's a chance for us to face up to the inequalities. What I realized during the lockdown was who are the people who are actually essential? You know, they're the people who are working in grocery shops, the farmers, truck drivers who are bringing goods, you know, et cetera. You know, these are the people who are not so well paid, you know, and many of the people who are well paid, well, you know, it's clear if they did nothing at all during the lockdown, it wouldn't matter that much, you know. So I think we have to revalue the relative importance of different occupations. And we have to try to somehow minimize the wage gap between these workers who are actually essential to society and the ones who are extremely well off, because in our current economics, you know, there are fewer of them, and so they get, you know, better paid. So I think we do need to think about our economic systems. That's what I meant. And it's perfectly, the listener is perfectly right that there is a real chance that this will make inequality worse.
So going back to the video again, so you in there you say all pandemics have brought out the best and the worst in humans. So what in your perspective has been the best and the worst seen in this pandemic so far?
Well, I would say the best is when people have come together and helped. For example, in the UK, when they imposed a lockdown, almost everybody, even if it was very inconvenient, they listened to it and you know, isolated themselves. People tried very hard to help each other. People started appreciating the healthcare workers, and healthcare workers did a heroic job, you know, of taking this huge overload of patients, you know, that came through the system, et cetera. So in that sense, you know, it brought out the best in people. So when disasters hit, communities will often try to help, you know, people will try to help each other in the community, you know, because they realize that they're stronger if they help each other, you know, and everyone has a better chance of coming through it. And this has been true of humanity all along. But it has also been true, and this is not just in this pandemic, but in every previous pandemic, including the Great Plague that destroyed, you know, a quarter of Europe's population, that it also creates prejudice. You know, people were prejudiced against, you know, foreigners, against outsiders, because they thought they would be carrying the disease. There was a chance to, you know, get rid of outsiders or people they didn't like. You can see that today, you know, in a kind of anti-China, you know, rhetoric, you know, that, oh, you know, this is a, you know, in the, especially people like Trump calling this a Chinese virus. Well, it could have originated anywhere. It happens, you know, to have originated probably in China, but, you know, that's not the fault of anybody, you know, that just happened to be the case. I mean, so Ebola, for example, came from Africa, you know, and there are other viruses originated elsewhere. And what we call the Spanish flu, which destroyed millions of people and killed millions of people in 1918, actually didn't come from Spain at all. You know, the most likely scenario is it originated somewhere in Kansas and was brought by American soldiers, you know, to Europe, you know. So I think this kind of prejudice and everybody sort of, you know, looking at themselves and looking at other people as different, that's some sort of the worst. And then some people have also tend to act selfishly. For example, you can see that, you know, all the supplies of toilet paper or hand wash, you know, sanitizers, all disappeared from the stores. You know, they were not thinking that, oh, you know, other people need it too. You know, they say, oh, I need my supply and, you know, I want, you know, to be sure. And then I heard in the US, lots of people were buying guns, you know, because they thought, oh, well, you know, people will come after my stuff, you know, and I need to protect myself. So I think this sort of shows you the sort of pettiness of humans as well.
Also, there was one question that you see. Yes, because you were talking about, you know, like hoarding things. And so there's a question that says about how can the poorest countries, what can they do about when some rich countries are hoarding drugs or medical equipment to combat the COVID-19?
Yeah, I think this is a terrible thing. For example, you know, buying up the entire supply of remdesivir, as was done by the US. You know, I think what people have to do is work through international organizations to try and ensure that there are generic routes for medicines. So, for example, in remdesivir, there has been a license to allow poorer countries to market it, to produce it and market it at lower cost. Okay. But if you're a well-off country that's not the US, then you don't have a supply, you know, because you have to go through the US. So it's a very complicated situation. I would say the way to do it is to have pharmaceutical companies that are not just based in rich countries. For example, India has a lot of very good pharmaceutical companies. I know there are some in South America. There are, of course, many in China. So I think, you know, if the capabilities are spread throughout the world and agreements are made that, you know, if something really turns out well, that it is widely licensed so that there isn't a, you know, monopoly on these drugs, that might make it more widely available.
The other question is, as I mentioned in the beginning, your Nobel Prize was for your research on the ribosome. That, among other applications, it has been important in the production of antibiotics. So the thing is that before the crazy COVID-19, antibiotics resistance was considered one of the biggest threats to global health. Now, after all that's been happening during this year, do you think that this threat and others we were considering before are not that big anymore, or that things actually can get worse?
Oh, I think it's still very much a threat, and it could be even in combination. For example, if you get a viral disease that inflames your lungs, etc., and makes you more susceptible to bacterial infection, then, you know, you could have a double problem. And one of the things that the world is really very poorly prepared for is, what if you get more than one emergency simultaneously? For example, you could have a pandemic, and in the middle of the pandemic, you have an earthquake or a flood, you know, and now you have to deal with multiple problems at the same time. And of course, we don't talk about the growing problem of climate change, which is like a slow, you know, increasing risk, you know, because it's happening at a rate that we don't seem to perceive in our everyday life, you know, and we slowly sort of get used to the next level and the next level and so on. And I think that's another serious problem. What would happen if, you know, you had combined risks of disease, flooding, you know, and other things? And so I think, you know, antimicrobial resistance is very much a continued risk, and you have to think of it as multiple risks that we face, and we have to try and be resilient by preparing for multiple risks. So when we insure our house, we don't just insure against flooding. You know, we also insure against fire, against, you know, damage by hurricanes, you know, et cetera. So you have to think of that as, you know, we need to sort of think about it as a comprehensive insurance policy.
So this person really did the homework. And so she says that she didn't study at top institutions in India nor in the US, and asks, why do you think you came so far as to win the Nobel Prize?
I think it's a combination of a lot of things. One is that if I didn't succeed at something, I didn't just leave science. I could have done that, and I could have gotten some other sort of job, but I either would change my field, like going from physics to biology, or changing my method of approach. For example, when I was about 40, I went off to learn crystallography, which helped me solve the structure of the ribosome. And then 10 years after the Nobel, 15 years later, my lab started learning electron microscopy because that was where the new technique was. So you have to be open to change and open to, also moving. You know, I moved around constantly to try and give myself a better opportunity. And many people don't want to make changes in their lives. And that's that's sometimes a barrier. But there's also a lot of luck in that, you know, the right sort of people, mentored me or gave me ideas. A lot of very talented people joined my lab as students or postdocs, without whom, you know, my ideas would still, nobody would have heard of them because nothing would have happened. So I think, you know, it's a combination of a lot of things. And anybody who, unless they're a theoretical physicist or a mathematician and they did it everything by themselves, and even they don't work in a vacuum, they work in an environment where people give them critical feedback. But certainly in a case like mine, I'm the product of a sort of ecosystem or an environment. You know, I can't really take very much of the credit just for myself. Okay.
And the last question, what piece of advice would you give to young people in order to face the future with hope?
Well, I would say, you know, we're in the middle of a pandemic now, but humanity has been through many pandemics before. And, you know, this pandemic may last a year or so, and then there'll be some solution that'll be found at some point, and things will eventually return to normal. And so what I, you know, you can see after the 1918 flu pandemic, we had the Roaring Twenties, you know, which was culturally, you know, it had all these, Hollywood was exploding and jazz and all sorts of things, okay? So I think, you know, we have to take the long, what I would tell young people is take the long view and think about what it is that you want to do and, you know, try to figure out how you can get there. You may not be able to get there in one step, but what would be the first step you could take to get towards your goal? And then keep in mind that your goals may change. You have to be a little bit flexible as you go along. But if you have no goals at all, then you will sort of wander along aimlessly, you know, through life. And that's not so great. You know, you may find out you're 60 years old and, you know, you didn't end up doing the things you really might have wanted to do. So I think you should try to have a goal and try to see how to get there and what will be the first, you know, small baby step towards that goal.
Well, I would like to keep you here, but I guess at some point I have to let you go. So thank you, Venky, for your time and expertise.
Thank you very much.
And now, if you excuse me, I'll switch back to Spanish. Okay. To say gracias a todos los que nos han enviado preguntas, no solamente para esta entrevista, sino para las nueve anteriores también, y por haber participado de este ciclo Imagina el Mundo de Hey Festival junto con BBC Mundo. Para ambos equipos ha sido un gusto realmente llevarles a estas 10 mentes brillantes a sus hogares en este tiempo con un poco de encierro y de incertidumbre. Así que esperamos haber aportado algo de claridad y también quizás un poco de optimismo. Así que hasta pronto y muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias por su atención.